it will be only me, so it's good to have everyone here. Om Sahana Vavatu Sahana Bhunaktu Sahaviryam Karavavahai Tejasvinabhadhitamastu Mavidvishavahai Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Dvasuparna Sayujha Sakhaya Vasuparna Sayujha Sakhaya Vasuparna Sayujha Sakhaya Samane Vrikshe Parishasva Jate I'm trying to correct it, so in my mind I'm going, because they are perched on the tree, so I keep going in seventh case. Samanam vriksham parishasva jate, samanam vriksham parishasva jate, tayoranyaf pippalam svadvati, tayoranyam pippalam svadvati, Anashnannanyo bhichakashiti Anashnannanyo bhichakashiti Which verse is it?
4-6.
Okay, yeah. Somehow we bungled through it. And grammatically, if we have to put it, if we have to write this verse now, it would all be changed. We would say, Dvau Suparnau Sayujau Sakhayau. Oh, okay? Yeah, because it's the dual. You know, here it is made into plural. Or Dva, something like that, Suparna, Suparnaha, something like that it is. So, we don't correct the Veda, but we have to understand that it is dual. Samane vrikshe parishasva jate, perhaps you could do that, or samanam vriksham also, because both of those are okay. And so here, you know, last time in 4-5, what is 4-5? Verse number 5, chapter 4. In 4-5, what did we see? We saw that there was, you know, three ajas, right? Yeah, and it was very cryptic, and all of it had to be unpacked properly. How can there be three ajas? You know, one aja was colorful, the other aja was without attributes, and then, you know, and then what? The one aja was colorful, the other aja was, you know, uninvolved, and the third one leaves both of them, something like that it was, and then we decoded all that. It was Jiva, you know, Ishvara and Jagat. Basically that's what it was. So we decoded all of that, and now we have another set of cryptic verses with birds in trees. Dvau Suparnau, two birds with Suparnau means shining wings, effulgent wings. Neon wings. Sayujau means they are almost like twins. Sayujau means they are united, almost identically united. Sakhayau, the greatest of friends. Sakha means friends. Sakhayau, two friends, totally in solidarity, united. What are they doing? Samanam vriksham means on the same tree, parishasva jate, are embracing or are perched, sit together very close to each other on the same tree, same limb. Here, unfortunately, the similarity ends. because their activities are completely different. What is one of them doing? Yeah, one of them is hop, skip and jump from one branch to another branch in search of berries. Yes, sweet berries, I may add. And the other one is also in search of berries? No, it just, you know, orders the first one to go bring it berries. No, it simply looks on. Without eating, it looks on. The other one, swadu atti. Atti means eats. Swadu, indeclinable. Swadu here means tasty, of varied tastes. Not tasty, but of many and varied tastes. What? Pippalam. Not to be confused with pipilika. Pipilika is what is upstairs. You know, what is pipilika? Ant. Ant is pipilika. And pippalam. Pippalam means berries. In fact, there is a character, a teacher in some of the Upanishads who features, called Pippalada. And his name, Pippalam, Pippalani Atti iti Pippalada, the one who eats berries. His name is Berry Eater. Yeah. And so, Pippalam is all kinds of berries. Whatever berry is growing on this tree. In fact, this is another synergy, because in the Kathopanishad we just finished with the tree. Only we thought we were finished, but we are not, because here the tree is featuring again. So one of them is hopping around eating berries. It's a has an addiction issue with regard to the berries. Addicted to the berries helplessly. And the other one just watches, you know, keeps on watching, that's all it does. Very cryptic, what is this? But we know, we start with the tree, we know what the tree is, because we studied it in the Kathopanishad as early as yesterday. So what is the tree? Samsara tree. And here, we can take it either as the samsara tree or the individual body, both. We can say the collective body called the Jagat, in which there's all kinds of things. You know, that's how the Kathopanishad presents it. And here also the tree, but let's take it as one body, one person's body. And then somewhere in the upper regions, near where the head should be, these birds are there. Buddhi birds. Actually, one of them is without buddhi. But anyhow, so they are in the buddhi, these birds. Two birds, shining birds, very interesting. So they lend their shine to the buddhi, making it come alive to the faculty of knowing. They lend their shine to the mind in which they reside. The mind shines because they shine. What they? Only one shines. What two? Only one shines. Which one? The eating one? The sleeping one? Just to make sure if there are any sleeping ones here. That's all. So, the eating one? No. The non-eating one, the simply sitting one, is the only one that shines. And its shine rubs off on the eating one. And that... its shine also rubs off on the tree in which it is sitting. It lights up the tree, burning bush, blazing bush, shiny bush. It lights up itself. It lights up everything else. It lights up the branch on which it is sitting, namely the mind, the buddhi. And it lights up nefarious activities of berry collection and berry inhalation, which the Upanishad says is very, very wrong, you know, in a number of ways. And so it highlights everything. So the shine does not belong to the tree. The shine does not belong to the what? The limbs of the tree. The shine does not belong to the flapping bird going up and down eating the berries. The shine does not belong to the berries either. There is only one neon self-shining thing, which is the one that is looking on. And this one eating too many berries gets a stomach ache, naturally. You know? And then what? The other one simply looks on. This is very cryptic, and so we can take it, if we take it as an individual body mind sense complex, the tree works better, because it has, you know, it has a trunk, and then somewhere on the top where the buddhi should be, these two birds are sitting. Or, you know, by a certain stretch, I suppose there is nothing wrong in looking at it as the tree of samsara, in which case it would be the collective body mind sense complex of all the jivas in which there is these two birds. So then, what are these birds? If you ask a Dvaitin, who is a Dvaitin? Yeah, a dualist, D-U-E-L-L-I-S-T, dualists always fighting, a duel. Yeah, because they have to keep, you know, what's that, buttressing their position and fighting for their position, which is very weak. So what will the dualist say? The dualist will say, one is the devotee bird. Devotee bird, devoted to Ishvara, and the other one is Ishvara. This metaphor doesn't work for me, because if it's the devotee bird, it should be singing bhajans with its little wings. Looking at the other one adoringly, it should, you know, be singing this. But instead, what is that bird brain doing? Ignoring the other one completely and eating berries. And the dualist will say, this is exactly what the problem is, because this bird has separated itself from Ishvara, that is why the problem. So we teach the Upanishads to this bird, which one? The one that is the berry holic, in the hope that it will come back and, you know, sing bhajans to and adore this bird, because it is supposed to be singing bhajans, but instead of singing bhajans, it is doing its own thing, bad bird. This is the dualist interpretation. And what do we say? We say that there is no dvau. There is no Suparnau, there is no dualist, there is nothing two. Even though the Upanishad mentions two, the two is because the one has not been understood. When the one has not been understood, it manifests as two. And when is the one not understood? The one is not understood when there is a mistake, or when there is some kind of an impairment in the vision. When is there an impairment in the vision? There is a very nice example right here. When there is an addiction. How many fingers? You ask a person, you know, who's had one too many, what? Berries. And fermented. But anyhow, so you go like this and say, how many fingers? Two. That's what the thing is. So the force of addiction to the very tree and its fruits. And now here, if we bring in, let's say the tree is the samsara tree, what kind of fruits will give? Dukkha. Dukkha is the fruit of samsara. Yeah. Dukkha is the fruit of samsara. And this fruit is inedible really. But in the hope that there will be some sweetness, this birdie is very much addicted to the fruits. So if you look at it from the standpoint of the samsara tree, this addicted bird needs an intervention. Yeah. Because it is behaving in a manner that is not healthy at all. Because it's going further away from its own truth. Because this bird, really speaking, is not an independent entity. That's what the Advaitins would say. This is what our interpretation would be. That that there are two birds is a spoof. It's a mistake because of the addiction. From the standpoint this story is told, that there are two birds is the standpoint, is told from the standpoint of the addicted bird, which sees two. But if the story were to be told from the standpoint of the other simply watching bird, there would be no two at all. There would be nothing else existing. But from the standpoint of the one who is struggling to come out of this addiction, but completely helpless and, you know, stuck to the taste of those berries, can't come out of that. From the standpoint of that bird, there is sorrow, there is helplessness and separation. Correct? What kind of a separation is it? It is a separation from the whole. And why do the Vedantins say that the two birds are really one? Because even the inimical means inimical to oneself, to itself. Even the inimical activities of bird number two are possible only because the bird number one is watching and lending its presence. So really speaking, there are no two birds. The one that is watching is lending its presence, and itself a non-actor is allowing and enabling the other bird to act in its own realm. Now this is very funny. Why doesn't it gets its own berries? Why does it have to watch and then lend its presence? Because the other bird is not really an entity. It's a mistake. It's a mistaken existence which the first neon bird is bringing to light. So the shining non-eating bird is bringing to light this ghora, this extreme samsara in which what? This bird is a berryholic. How many antioxidants it's getting? You know how many? Because all the berries have antioxidants. And the tree itself is unstable. And so the bird also feels very insecure and unstable. And it thinks, if I have more berries, I'll be more secure. And so the tree shakes in the wind and the bird says, oh no, I think I need to have some berries and put them in the bank for my babies. And for the babies, babies. And for their babies, 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 babies. This is a funny bird. Usually animals don't think of the next generation. The dog may bury one bone for itself for later. But it does not say, this bone is the trust fund for my grandchild. This bone is, for the next generation. No, it's only us. We have this special capacity to go against nature everywhere at all times. Funny thinking. And you think also of other things. How much effort is put in building a house? And how much that is an emotional feeling. It has to be my house. Oh my God, finally it is my house. And no, Baba, it is not your house. It belongs to the bank, firmly and squarely. Even the little certificate that says it's your house is with them, namely deed. So it is not your deed. It belongs to the bank. No, but at least I can live here. And yes, you're paying money every month. And in fact, it's no different than rent. So if you keep renting also, it's the same thing. No, after 30 years I'll own it. Will you be here after 30 years? I hope so. Yeah, everybody hopes so. That's all it is. It's hinged on some hope. And so in order to build the house, the person gets so stressed out and has to have this and has to have that, and then oh my God, and then there is the moving in day, and then it's endless because vans after vans after vans of berries, are being deposited, cold storage berries, this berries, that berries, furniture, this, that, wallpaper also has berry design, and this samsaraholic finally moves into the house. Abba, big achievement. And then what? Look at the bird. without a PhD, the bird builds a nest, beautiful one, with all the things that were readily available. Twigs are there, sticks are there, all things are there, and it will build. And there's this weaver bird, what a nice the nest it builds. And then from the outside it looks very beautiful, like this, you know, small little funnel. But inside it's even nicer, it's 5-star. It knows that all these twigs which it has brought in are very harsh, for then the babies are so soft and small, tiny. And so it goes and, you know, gets some cotton, little pieces of fabric, it's amazing. And it weaves that along with the twigs. And then it gets some feathers from, you know, that other birds have dropped. Doesn't go and pluck them, but gets the feathers. And it has a nest lined with feathers. All this it does just to have the babies and the eggs, for the eggs to hatch. And then they go cheep and they eat a few worms, get big and fly away. And the bird abandons the nest. It builds a dream house with all the things. Few rooms will also be there, yeah. And children's play room, you know, puja room, everything in that nest. And then what? And then it just leaves the nest. Because winter is coming, it has to migrate. In this weather it cannot stay. It cannot say, oh, I think I should have a little heater there. The whole thing will go up in smoke. A little space heater is all I need. It can't go and do that. All its friends call, okay, your, you know, empty nest syndrome, your babies have flown, you have raised a wonderful family. In fact, those babies are also now, they are young adults, they are getting ready to migrate south. Everyone is going, come. And you don't put a sentry in front of the door, security, when I'm gone. Another mean looking bird, you know, carrying a gun, walking back and forth. Or the bird doesn't build its house in a gated community because, you know, it's all taken care of, condo. No, it just leaves and goes. And then next season when it comes back, it doesn't look, where was that? Oh, was it in this tree or was it? Oh, look what they have done when I have gone. Look at these people. They took it and put it in a museum. How dare they? I need this house to be returned to me. It's mine. In a way, it's just so beautiful because, you know, there is not much of a, what's that, there's no, nothing they do is laden with sorrow. The same things we do, you know, human beings, they also build houses, raise young, you know, live there, and they also migrate south, everybody goes to Florida, and they have another house there. And then they come back, you know, but it's so complicated. That's because we have firmly identified with the bird which is suffering from addiction. And when the addicted one makes decisions, what kind of decisions will they be? They will all be based on how to feed the addiction. This is what this whole section, the next 4 verses are going to teach us this. No, not 4, maybe, yeah, I think 4. At least if this was in the Mundaka Upanishad, it would have been 4. Let's see how many here. So this one, yeah, only the next 2 verses. There are 2 more which are not here. So, this is what the whole thing is, that the addiction cannot be a basis for making decisions about one's life. And here, this bird is already separated from the truth of itself. Because first it doesn't know, and second, because it doesn't know, it gets insecure and drowns itself in the addiction in the hope of creating some kind of a security for itself. It thinks by hoarding the berries and eating the berries, it's going to be a secure bird. But it is not. all it has to do is look at the one that's not doing anything, which is its real self. So generally, when people talk about it, they say the first bird is a jiva bird, as the one who is flopping around, and the bird that is looking on without eating is Ishvara bird. But really speaking, that would be, you know, that would be okay if we understood what jiva is. What is jiva? Ah, exactly. Jiva is Ishvara plus ignorance. That's all it is. So, is Bhagavan plus ignorance is jiva. So, from the stand, there is only one. And that same presence, you know, is that bird. That's why both of them are of one, you know, one body. Sayujau, Sakhayau, they are friendly. They are the greatest friend and they are united. What is the separating factor? Ignorance. And because of the ignorance, they do all kinds of, at least the one keeps doing all kinds of nonsensical things. Thinking that it is an independent individual actor. That's why it has berry storage. It opens and has all the berries there in cold storage, and it is collecting more berries for the next generation. Why? Because it thinks it has to act on its own behalf, because it is all alone in the world of other birds who are also all by themselves, and so from between bird and bird there is competition, and this one wants to put that one down and become richer. If this one hoards the berries, that one buys all the trees, and you know, and the third one says, you know, you can't buy this tree, it's already mine, and the third one owns a whole orchard, a berry orchard. And the fourth one says, ah, you just have one orchard, I have five orchards, and I'm about to buy your orchard too. So like this, it goes on escalating. Why? Because the simple thing about its own nature, that it is not a berry hunter, is not understood. That is not understood. And so what it has to do is study Vedanta. no other way of understanding this. And so this whole setup, in this mantra, the whole thing is set up. Vau Suparnau Sayujau Sakhayau Samanam Viksham Parishasva Jate. This is just a setup of this whole samsara to show that when one, because of one's own fears and insecurities, when one thinks of oneself as a doer, then what happens? One separates oneself from the whole, because you are not the doer. And also this doership is brought about here because it is both the vision and the method, an auxiliary method of attaining the vision. The best way of attaining this vision of non-doership is exposing oneself to the teachings of Vedanta. But while one is doing that, there is an auxiliary method of dedicating the doership to the Lord, which is also called KY, Karma Yoga. This is Karma Yoga. So this Karma Yoga is, you know, through that I practice non-doership because I attribute the doership to the Lord. So I keep myself, you know, free and safe from any kind of a hubris. Both a hubris and then a fall arising from this attaching to the notion of doership. Because when I associate my identity with that of a doer, then disaster results. Why does disaster result? Because if it goes well, then I'm on top of the world, ecstasy. And of course, the very next minute, it doesn't go well, agony. So the ecstasy and the agony, you know, it keeps me in this loop. And so therefore, the second bird, which is the truth of the first one, in fact, the second bird is the light, the one that doesn't eat. And the first bird is the shadow. Really speaking, how many birds are there? ekah devah, one shining self which is as though split from itself. And both of them, interestingly, are in the same place. So the insecure one hopping around in the head, you can see. When you really close your eyes and think about it, you're immediately in touch with the insecure one that is hopping around, trying to wonder how to make itself more safe. And then do some pranayama or yoga, and then you're immediately in touch with the other one, the witness of this one, which is itself not seeking anything. Very beautiful, you know, mantra. So let us call the first bird Anihisha bird, the one that is hopping around. And the second one is what? Isha. Isha and Anihisha, great friends, sitting on the same tree with shining ones. Anihisha is addicted to berries, and Isha simply watches on. Watches on means without Isha, there is no Anihisha. Without Anihisha, definitely there only is Isha. Anihisha is a spoof, a shadow bird, which the light of this one and only bird casts a shadow. And why is it called Anihisha? Because it has gone rogue. It refuses to connect with Isha. Bad bird. It refuses to connect with Isha. It says, I apply for cessation. Like Texas, they wanted to secede from the United States and be their own country, you know. And so, like that, it says, I want to be by myself. And Isha bird goes, you know, without shrugging its shoulders, it says, whatever. Doesn't even say whatever, it simply looks on, it shines the light, look at you, what are you doing? And Anihisha says, I don't care, I want to be by myself. Let me out of this whole mess. I want to be free. And then what? Then it's all lonely. It looks around, so many berries. What am I going to do with all this? And after having all these berries, I'm still sad. And then it cries, let me in. I want back in. Study some Vedanta. How? Let's look at the next verse. Samane vrikshe purusho nimagnah.
Samane vrikshe purusho nimagnah.
Anishaya shochati muhyamanah.
Anishaya shochati muhyamanah.
Anishaya shochati muhyamanah.
Anishaya shochati muhyamanah.
Jushtam yada pashyati anyamisham.
Jushtam yada pashyati anyamisham.
Asya mahimanamiti vita shokah.
Asya mahimanamiti vita shokah.
Yeah. Samane vrikshe, in the same tree, why is that highlighted? Because it's the same tree where that shining one resides, correct? But now the shining one and the unshining one are both residing. Purushaha nimagnaha. Nimagnaha literally means glub, 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 drowning. From mudge to drown, ni nishchayena magnaha, definitely drowning. Where in the same tree one of them is drowning, let us call this one no longer bird. First was the drishtanta, now is what? Darshtanta, that which is exemplified. First was the example, then the second set of these two lines are that which is exemplified. So the bird has been quietly converted into Purusha. Purusha of the Purusha Suktam, how holy! Sahasrashirsha Purusha, Sahasrakshas Sahasrapat. This is Ishvara's name, Purusha. Sarvan Purayati iti Purusha. And what does this Purusha do? Well, just wait and see in the Purusha Suktam, the praise song for the Lord here, in the most abstract, all-encompassing form. Every head is this Lord's head, Sahasra Shirsha, having thousands of heads. Sahasraksha, so 1,000 head means minimum 2,000 pairs of eyes. Yeah. You know, and as many thousand feet. And, you know, is all over the whole universe. Wraps itself, this Purusha, around the whole universe and transcends it also. Purusha is like the wrap. You know, you make a wrap and inside you put all kinds of things and then you eat it. So Purusha encompasses everything. Is that the same Purusha here? Alas. Yeah. No. That Purusha is Bhagavan. And what is this Purusha? This Purusha is a Bhagavan. Not Bhagavan. Why? Because even though it's the same word, the derivation is different. There in the Purusha Suktam, Sarvan Purayati iti Purusha. And here what? Purishayanam Purishete. Shing Shayane. The one who is locked up sleeps the sleep of ignorance in this city, nay, citadel of the body, mind, sense complex. So that one, you know, suits this person more, the one that is being described. The one who drowning, because the other Purusha will not be drowning. That's our first key, that which Purusha is being described. But deliberately the Upanishad uses the word Purusha because it has these two derivations. At once ignorance, glub, 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 at once all knowledge, you know, fills up everything. So, samane vrikshe, in that same tree, as what? The other Purusha. In the same tree where the other Purusha, the one that fills up everything, is there. In that same location, which is the body, mind, sense complex, the tree here, that's why the body, in that same place, both of them shine, one difference alone, this one drowns, the other one looks on. Yeah. But so mean, can't it throw a little lasso or a little, you know, stick to rescue? You know, that's not nice. This one just looks on, how mean. I mean, what's the point of being Bhagavan when this Bhagavan can't even, you know, give one stick, okay, catch this and come out. I just have a simple question for you. When you are walking by the water and your shadow falls on the water and on the river, do you then call 911? Do you call the lifeguard? Do you yourself start swimming after the shadow to rescue it? No, you also simply look on, right? You are also simply looking on. How hot? How can you be so heartless? Just looking on, poor shadow is drowning. It's coming out for air. It's hyperventilating. It's drowning. And now it's in the water. And now someone threw a boulder on top of the shadow because some children were, you know, playing, putting pebbles and rocks in the river, and they drowned the shadow even more because they put a rock. They threw, one of them threw quite a nice hefty sized rock on the shadow, where exactly where the head was. And so glub, 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 shadow is drowning, call 911. And now that's why they have made it an offense that if you call 911 for no reason, they're going to catch you, not the shadow, okay? Yeah. So you can't call 911. I mean, people in America, they're, you know, some of them, they don't know the difference. So one man called 911 because when he brought some you know, animal in between two buns in McDonald's, and on top of that there was no what did they put?
Ketchup.
Yeah, and the mustard was missing. So he called 911. Of course, he was highly inebriated. Same thing, I'm telling you, drunk. Highly inebriated, slurring the words, and he's saying there's no mustard on the bread. from McDonald's. And so they tried to explain him, and he started to get very abusive. But since he was calling from the cell phone, his location was immediately, and when you call 911, your location is beamed all the way up to Mars. So everybody knows where you are, and they caught hold of him. Yes, and so like this, so many things are there. So really speaking, you can't call 911, and you don't want to, because anybody in the right mind knows that if the shadow falls on the water, it doesn't need to be rescued. So too, the shining bird is not doing anything when this shadow gone rogue is saying, help, save me, glub, glub, glub. Why? Shochati. It is drowning. Now we find out something else about the river water. It's salty. Why? I thought only the ocean water is salty, because this shadow is a drowning in a river of its own tears and its own fears. It's being swept away, glub, 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 engulfed by its own tears and fears. Shady tears, shadowy fears. When the shadow drowning in the shadow tears. And then it says, rescue me. What? A non-entity. A non-entity says, rescue me. And so what does the other one do? It just looks on compassionately. It shines the flashlight of its own neon self. It lights up the shoka. What is shoka? That which happens when you have a shock. Shoka, shoka, same thing. There's the sorrow. It lights up the sorrow. And in order to light up the sorrow, what should it be? It should also be sorrowful, right? Sniffing, sniffing it, and crying, crying. It should light up the sorrow. No, it is all ananda. It is Sachidananda lights up the sorrow. So the next time you cry, you think about this. Just say it is Ananda crying. Ananda is shedding the tears, because Ananda is all that there is. Ananda is upholding the sorrow, and Ananda is so generous because it even upholds the non-entity and everything it brings to light. So it brings to light the self-existent self, namely itself, and it brings to light that which is an object of the self-existent self, which is not self-existent, which is an iffy dependent reality, where this Purusha, which one? The sleeper in the city. Now the sleeper has become the dreamer. First slept the sleep of ignorance, and when the ignorance goes to sleep, the ignorant goes to sleep, the dreams are also equally ignorant, and is in the middle. Now the sleeper has turned into a dreamer and is in the middle of a nightmare. Glub, 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 drowning, help! So, this being the case, it is just the result of all the subjectivity. Yeah. Subjectivity is a product of self-ignorance. Pratibhasika means, subjectivity, one's own rendition of the world and the things in it, colored by, eclipsed by one's own, fears and tears, one's own ragadveshas. So, anishaya shochati. Anishaya ittham bhute tritiya. In the form of anisha, it grieves. How? What is this anisha? Not isha, exactly. Isha means all-encompassing. Isha means the ruler. Isha means, fully cognizant of itself. Isha means grand. Anisha means small. Anisha means nearly non-existent. Anisha means full of tears and fears. Anisha means insecure. So this Purusha grieves because of identification with Anisha rather than Isha. Anisha is shadow. Anisha is ultimately non-existent. Only Isha is existent. Not knowing that, if I, hitch my truck to the engine of Anisha, it is headed towards a destiny that I don't want to go to. So it'll crash somewhere, and so this is what anishaya shochati, grieves. Why? Mukhyamanasan, deluded. deluded it grieves, very sadly it grieves, grievati, keeps on grieving. And then what happens? You know, anishaya shochati muhyamanah, jushtam yada pashyati. Jushtam means worshipfully. Yeah, the one, not worshipfully, worshipful. Jushtaha means the one that is adored by everyone. This light of all lights, one that is adored, when this one sees, pashyati anyamisham, when it sees the other one, which is the Lord, and sees its greatness, mahimanam pashyati, ishasya mahimanam pashyati, jushtam yada pashyati, ishasya mahimanam pashyati, then what happens? Vita shoko bhavati, becomes free of sadness. Free of sadness. So, very interesting. Muhyamanaha and Mahimanam. Kind of, you know, they rhyme. Mahimana and Muhyamana. Mahimana means what? The glory. And Muhyamana means delusion. You know? Muhyamana means deluded, and the one who has mahima, you know, that one, when it sees, and when it sees that greatness, so the inglorious views the glorious worshipfully as an extension and the truth of itself, adoringly, jushtam. And Ishvara is adorable because it is the truth of me, and this is what I want through all the ragadveshas. And I went on my own thinking that nobody will help me, and nobody will help me, understand this. And I felt very alone, so I thought I should go on my own. I had no trust. And when I went off on my own, I wandered off, got lost, and started to drown in my tears, and therefore had to walk back. To this only Isha, because the Anisha is a spoof, all that is there is Isha. So Jushtam Yada Pashyati, you know, Isham Asya Mahimanam Yada Pashyati, then what? Vita Shoko Bhavati. So this is a very important promise which we have to take seriously, because elsewhere in the other Upanishads also, Shoka Nivritti is seen as the cause of the freedom from samsara. Being free of Shoka is seen as freedom from samsara. And in other Upanishads it is fear, bhaya, bhaya nivritti and Shoka Nivritti. So here it is Shoka, because that glub glub is there, so wallowing in its own tears, starting a pity party, and having a support group of other people wallowing in their own tears, that's where it has gone to, because of its having gone rogue, having gone away from everything because of its own ignorance, and because of the ignorance there is all these other problems, and then it has to make a U-turn and come back. And then what? This bird will sing praises of the other bird, and then it will go with the flow, and then it will, quote unquote, become the other bird, or be integrated into the other bird, and there is no more sorrow. Therefore, vita shoko bhavati. So there is a two-step upaya, remedy given. What is the first step? The first step is to recognize Ishvara and greatness, and, you know, and succumb to Ishvara, surrender to Ishvara. How? You know, jushtam, by adoring Ishvara and seeing that this is indeed adorable. I mean, I don't know who you are, I don't know where you are, but you are running the show. It is abundantly clear, because I'm not, and nobody locally is able to do this, we know that. And so, sees that very clearly, and then what does it do? It it subsumes its own limitations into the altar that is limitless. So the limitless is big enough to hold the limitations of all beings, because the limitations are not real. All there is limitless. So if all there is limitless, where did limitations come from? So does are limitations included in the limitless? Obviously, because they are not a parallel reality to limitlessness. Limitlessness means there cannot be a parallel reality. So the limitations are but notions which limitlessness is big enough to just subsume and to keep eating. And so that the one with notions of limitations, you know, surrenders to that which is limitless. And then what happens to the limitations? They go away. They go away. That's why, you know, worship, bhajans, all these activities, they have a certain absorption. Meditation also. You keep taking the name of the Lord. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, Om Namah Shivaya. You keep taking, and then you become the chant. And when you become the chant, what happens? You know, there's nothing more left. That is Sayuja. That is that oneness. That is already there. That oneness is already there. It's just highlighted in the worship and the meditation. And it's a much better way of highlighting that than going to malls and balls. In the mall and ball also it's highlighted, because there's a disappearance of the wanting person in the light of buying something and feeling good immediately afterwards. But then how long does that last? Not much, because the very next day you go and return it. And so that itself shows that this discontent cannot be removed by add-ons. You keep adding on this, that or the other. It's insecure plus add on. Insecure plus 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 plus. And all these pluses are a big minus. So instead, you know, surrender the limitations at the altar that is limitless. And then what? Then afterwards, the second stage is that there is no shoka. There's one more piece I think I'm forgetting. Let us see. One more word between no shoka and this thing, what is that? Mahimanam pashyati. So mahimanam pashyati and mahimanam drishtva vita shoko bhavati means what? Goes beyond sorrow. How can it go beyond sorrow? It goes beyond sorrow because the sorrow is not real. That's why it is able to go beyond sorrow. If sorrow is real, it will be stuck in the little whirlpool of sorrow. It keeps moving because the sorrow is a superimposition on that Atma. So the other bird is a superimposition, as it were, on the one and only bird, the self-shining bird that doesn't do anything. The other bird is an overlay, an as though overlay, using the same things, using the same being, you just bring forth another being, as it were. But the other one doesn't have is not deserving to be called a being, because it's not an independent being, it's a dependent being. It's just a shadow cast from the light of the first one, and so the other one really is non-existent. So how does the non-existent one, you know, become sad because it thought itself to be existent and it thought itself to be limited? So how to walk back from here? To walk back from here, all the limitations are bundled up in a big bag, and then, you know, let go of at the feet of that which is all glorious, and its glory belongs also to me. I am included in this glory, first level of comprehension, and the final level is I am nothing but an extension of this glory. I am this glory. So there is a greater owning up that takes place. Then yeah, the next one is very beautiful, and we will see that next month. Very beautiful. Of what use of the Vedas, of what use is everything if you don't know this truth. Very nice. And then we have two verses dedicated, three verses dedicated to Maya. Then after that we have seen this. This is a repeat. Yo devanam prabhavaschodbhavascha vishwadhipo rudro maharshihi hiranyagarbham pasyate pasyatajayamanam sano buddhya shubhaya samyunaktu. We have seen this. And it was in this itself, somewhere it has come. 3-4, you already found that? Yeah, exactly the same or slightly different? Yo devanam, yeah, hiranyagarbham pasyatajayamanam. Here, the third line is different. Yeah, same thing, vishwadhipo. Same thing, both are vishwadhipo. Vishwadhipo rudro maharshihi. Then the third line is different. Hiranyagarbham jayama janayama sapurvam. And here Hiranyagarbham pasyata jayamanam. Yeah, it's the same thing. We can skip that one. Yeah, very nice. This is a long chapter, I say. Yeah, but very beautiful. So we'll see that next time. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti
Shanti Hari Om
Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Hari Om. Yeah, very nice. I'm so glad you had a peaceful day. Wonderful. Wonderful.